Hello everyone, welcome to my channel Capsule. Today we are diving into a critical area of immunology, autoimmunity. These are diseases where incredibly your own body turns against itself. This is not rare. The NIH estimates that up to 8% of the population is affected, and there are over 80 different autoimmune diseases. In autoimmunity, the immune system, which is designed to protect us from invaders like bacteria and viruses, gets confused. Instead of targeting those foreign invaders, it starts attacking the body's own tissues, your own cells, your own organs. This attack can be driven by different components of the immune system, including antibodies and T cells. These diseases are often chronic and debilitating, significantly impacting quality of life. It's crucial to understand how and why this happens. So please pay close attention. For a long time, the idea that the immune system could attack itself was considered unthinkable. The great Paul Ehrlich, a pioneer in immunology, even coined the term horror autotoxicus. Essentially, the body's supposed horror of self-destruction, reflecting the belief that the body could never attack itself. This view held sway for many years. But that view dramatically changes in 1957, thanks to the groundbreaking work of Deborah Doniach and her colleagues in London. They made a landmark discovery at the molecular level. They found that patients with Hashimoto's thyroiditis had antibodies in their blood that were significantly targeting and reacting with normal components of their own thyroid cells. This was a pivotal moment. It provided the first clear evidence that cell reactivity not only exists but is a key factor in causing diseases. Doniach's work also extended to type 1 diabetes, showing its autoimmune nature. This discovery truly revolutionized our understanding of how the immune system can go wrong. To understand autoimmunity, you first need to understand how the immune system normally distinguishes between self and non-self. So our bodies have a remarkable ability called immune tolerance. This is the ability of our immune system to recognize what is self, our own cells, proteins, tissues, and to leave them alone without mounting an attack. This tolerance is primarily established through two key processes. First, central tolerance occurs in the primary lymphoid organs, the thymus for T cells, and the bone marrow for B cells. Here, immune cells that are strongly reactive to self-antigens are eliminated or modified during their development. It's like a rigorous training camp where potentially dangerous recruits are weeded out. Second, peripheral tolerance acts as a crucial backup system. It operates outside the primary lymphoid organs in the rest of the body. Its job is to control any self-reactive immune cells that might have escaped central tolerance. This involves mechanisms like inactivating these cells, suppressing their activity, or even eliminating them. Autoimmunity arises when this delicate balance breaks down. Instead of recognizing and tolerating self, the immune system mistakenly mounts an attack against the body's own components, which we call self-antigens. Several factors can contribute to this breakdown. One important concept is molecular mimicry. This is where a pathogen, like a bacterium or virus, carries antigens that are very similar in structure to some of our own self-antigens. In such cases, an immune response directed against the pathogen can, unfortunately, also end up targeting our own tissues. But it's rarely just one thing. It's usually a complex interplay of genetic susceptibility, meaning you are born with certain genes that increase your risk, and environmental triggers, which can include infections, toxins, and other factors. Now let's delve into a molecular mechanisms by which this self-attack occurs. There are two main players, autoantibodies and self-reactive T-cells. First, autoantibodies. These are antibodies, proteins that normally act like guided missiles, targeting foreign invaders. In autoimmunity, the body produces antibodies that mistakenly recognize and bind to its own cells or tissues. These autoantibodies can cause damage in several ways. They can directly attack cells, triggering processes like complement activation, which leads to cell lysis or destruction. Or they can interfere with normal cellular function. For example, they might block receptors on cells, preventing them from receiving important signals, or they might overstimulate receptors, causing them to malfunction. The key or second key mechanism involves self-reactive T cells. T cells are another type of white blood cell crucial for coordinating and executing immune responses. Normally, T cells are trained to recognize and attack only foreign antigens. But in autoimmunity, some T cells escape this training and become reactive to self-antigens. There are different types of T cells involved. Cytotoxic T cells, also known as killer T cells, directly kill cells that they recognize as being self but abnormal. Helper T cells, on the other hand, don't directly kill cells. Instead, they orchestrate the immune response. Different subsets of T cells contribute to different ways. Th1 cells promote inflammation and activate macrophages and cytotoxic T cells, driving cell-mediated damage. Th2 cells primarily activate B cells, leading to production of those harmful autoantibodies. And Th17 cells are another subset that promotes inflammation, often contributing to tissue damage. Now, because autoimmune disease can affect virtually any organ or tissue in the body, we classify them in a couple of ways. But the most common is based on the extent of the disease. First, we have organ-specific autoimmune disease. In these conditions, the immune response is primarily directed against antigens that are unique to a single organ or a gland. This means the disease manifestations are largely limited to that particular organ. The damage can occur through direct attack by immune cells or antibodies, or by antibodies interfering with the organ's normal function. Examples include Hashimoto's thyroiditis, where thyroid gland is targeted, type 1 diabetes, where the insulin-producing cells of the pancreas are attacked, Graves' disease, another autoimmune disease of the thyroid, Addison's disease, affecting the adrenal glands, and myasthenia gravis, which affects the communication between nerves and the muscles. In contrast, systemic autoimmune diseases involve an immune response that targets antigens that are present in multiple organs or tissues throughout the body. As you can imagine, these diseases tend to have much more widespread clinical manifestations affecting many different systems. Examples include rheumatoid arthritis, which primarily affect the joints but can also involve other organs, systemic lupus erythematosus or SLE, which can affect skin, joints, kidneys, brain, and other organs also, multiple sclerosis, which targets the central nervous system, Sjögren syndrome, which affects moisture-producing glands, and systemic sclerosis, which affects the skin and connective tissues. Now the big question, why does the immune system turn rogue? Why does it start attacking the body it's supposed to protect? The answer is, as you might guess, it's complex. It's rarely a single cause, but rather a combination of several interacting factors. First, there is a strong genetic component. certain genes, particularly those in HLA or human leukocyte antigen system, play a critical role in how our immune system recognizes self from non-self. Specific variations in these HLA genes can significantly increase a person's susceptibility to developing particular autoimmune diseases. For example, certain HLA variants are strongly associated with type 1 diabetes and rheumatoid arthritis. But it's important to emphasize that genes alone are usually not sufficient to cause autoimmunity. They create a predisposition, not a certainty. Environmental triggers are also crucial. A variety of external factors can contribute to the development or exacerbation of autoimmune disease in genetically susceptible individuals. These triggers can include infections where a pathogen might mimic a self-antigen, confusing the immune system, certain drugs and chemicals, dietary factors, and even lifestyle factors like smoking. Hormones also appear to play a significant role. The fact that many autoimmune diseases such as lupus and Hashimoto's are much more common in women suggests a link between sex hormone and immunoregulation. Finally, there are defects in the immune system's own regulatory mechanisms. Normally, we have specialized cells called regulatory T cells, or regulatory T cells in short, Tregs, which job it is to suppress immune responses and prevent the immune system from overreacting and attacking self. In many autoimmune diseases, these Tregs are either deficient in number or not functioning properly. Another important mechanism is defective apoptosis or programmed cell death. Normally, when immune cells that recognize self-antigens are no longer needed, they undergo apoptosis, a controlled cell destruction process. If this process is faulty, these self-reactive cells can survive and cause damage. And lastly, there is a process called epitope spreading, where the immune response initially targets one self-antigen, but then begins to target other self-antigens within the same tissue, leading to a broadening and worsening of the autoimmune attack. Now, diagnosing autoimmune disease can be a real challenge. There is often no single definitive test. Doctors have to carefully piece together the puzzle, considering a range of clinical and laboratory findings. The diagnostic process typically involves several key steps. First, a thorough medical history and physical examination are essential to identify the patient's symptoms and signs. Then blood tests play a crucial role. These tests can detect the presence of specific autoantibodies, which are often characteristic of particular autoimmune diseases. For example, we look for anti-nuclear antibodies or ANAs in lupus, rheumatoid factor in rheumatoid arthritis, and anti-thyroid antibodies in Hashimoto's thyroiditis. We also measure general markers in inflammation such as C-reactive protein and erythrocyte sedimentation rate, which can indicate the presence of an autoimmune process. In some cases, a tissue biopsy where a small sample of the affected tissue is examined under a microscope can provide valuable information. And finally, and very important, doctors must carefully rule out other diseases that might have similar symptoms, a process called differential diagnosis. Given the absence of the universal cures for most autoimmune diseases, our treatment strategies center on a delicate balancing act, modulating the immune system to alleviate the suffering and prevent further self-inflict damage. The goals are to reduce symptoms, calm inflammation, restrain overzealous immune response, and preserve organ integrity. We employ several categories of therapeutic agents, immunosuppressive drugs, broad spectrum, and agents like corticosteroids, methotrexate, azathioprine, and cyclophosphamide, which dampen overall immune activity, disease-modifying anti-rheumatoid drugs, or DMARDs, agents like sulfasalazine, leflunomide, and hydroxychloroquine modify the disease process, especially in joint destruction. Biologics, targeted therapies, precisely engineered agents target specific molecules or cells, such as TNF inhibitors, B-cell depleting agents, and interleukin inhibitors. Small molecule inhibitors, agents like JAK inhibitors, like tofacitinib, disrupt the intracellular signaling pathways. In addition to these immune modulating therapies, we also employ symptomatic treatments such as pain relievers and physical therapy to enhance the patient's comfort and function. The field of autoimmune disease treatment is rapidly evolving with emerging therapies and including cell-based and gene therapies, offering the promise of even more precise and personalized interventions in the recent years. So to wrap up, autoimmune diseases are a complex group of disorders where body's defense system goes awry and attacks its own tissues. These diseases arise from a complex interplay of genetic, environmental, and immunological factors. They are characterized by a breakdown of immune tolerance and a misdirected attack on self tissues. This can lead to a wide range of clinical manifestations, from organ-specific diseases like Hashimoto's to systemic diseases like lupus. Diagnosing this condition can be challenging, and treatment primarily focuses on managing symptoms and suppressing the harmful immune response. But research is ongoing, and we are continually gaining a better understanding of these diseases, which will hopefully lead to more effective therapies in the future. If you found this information helpful, please like, comment, and share this video with who needed this. And don't forget to subscribe to the channel for more in-depth explanation of complex medical topics. Thank you.